All right, thank you. Thank you very much, Israel, and thank you to the IFELTO board for inviting me and putting this webinar series together. It is indeed a pleasure to be a part of this. Today we're going to be talking about authentic media in the remote classroom. And so I hope to share with you ideas that you can take away, scaffold, adapt for the language you teach. It's just a pleasure to be here on behalf of Vista Higher Learning, the Indiana Language Roadmap, and the IFLTA in Indiana. So we're going to jump right in. You will be getting the slides, I understand, or have access to them, so don't feel like you have to take notes this evening, and we'll jump right in. Our takeaways, you may have seen this already on the social media, but we're going to talk about sort of different avenues to approaching this authentic media. One of which I'd like to address is culturally responsive teaching. I think that means different things depending on whom you ask. And so we'll look at some of those different facets of what that really means. Of course, we as language teachers are cultural teachers, right? We never separate the two, I think. We're going to talk about how to use authentic media. That is something written or spoken by a native speaker intended for a native speaker. And then we, of course, have to be creative and adapt that for our novice, intermediate, maybe our pre-advanced learners. So I'm going to show you an example of that. In fact, we'll end with one of those examples where I take just a short 30-second video clip and scaffold that up and down. We're going to talk about different strategies for engagement. That's especially a challenge now that we're teaching remotely. How do we keep them engaged with a screen hour after hour? I'll be showing you some new digital tools that you may or may not be familiar with, especially to address the interpersonal mode. Those are some tools from Vista, and I will show you how to try them out if you've not used them before. And then kind of, like I say, frame everything within this definition of intercultural competence. What does that mean for both the teacher and the student? I'm going to start us off with a quote here from a colleague. I was down in Katy, Texas about a year ago, and I thought this really resonated with me, that culturally responsive teaching is more of a mindset. It really speaks to those cultural perspectives. It embraces the values, the underpinnings, the belief systems, if you will, excuse me, behind the culture, and then also making students feel valued and respected. And I think one way that we can really address that is using the students as resources. I know this is especially true if you teach a lot of heritage students, that they are such valuable resources. They bring a wealth of experience to our classroom, all different kinds of backgrounds. They're eager to talk about that usually, assuming they have had a pleasant experience adjusting to this country, or if they were born here. I work with a lot of students in New York City and all the boroughs, and it's just been so enriching to talk about the melting pot that is New York City and capitalize on the different experiences they bring, whether that be variation in vocabulary, to, you know, how do you say it in your country, regionalisms, that sort of thing. I just really think that is a valuable tool that sometimes goes unnoticed, perhaps. Thinking about the globally competent student, I know we talk about a lot of times at Vista that we build global citizens, and that's been part of our school's mission statement for a long time. As Israel said, I'm now at Duke University, but I taught for 30 years in a public high school here in North Carolina. And Chapel Hill, if you know the town, we're not without our struggles. We certainly have seen division along socioeconomic, racial lines, even linguistic lines for this particular audience. And we want to think about how do we break down some of those barriers for our students? How do we pique their curiosity and connect them with the world around them? I always tell my students, you don't have to travel anymore to use a language, right? That we live in a Spanish-speaking country. And I know that may be true for different parts of the country where you are living and teaching, but I think that's especially important to connect them to their surrounding, to think about their own community through the lens of the target language community. So let's just take those into account as we delve into some strategies later on this evening, but really developing those cross-cultural skills. Another quote here, I'll let you read this for yourself. think about for a minute, what does that mean, right? For, you know, the reduction of anxiety, I couldn't think of a better recommendation right now, right? This openness to learning, and like I say, really piquing their curiosity for why are they there. I think if you ask your students, why did you take this course? Many times the response I got in high school, well, my mom or my dad thought this was a good idea, or it was the lesser of some other evil in the schedule, or I'm just here to fulfill a requirement. But in the at the end of the day, we really hope that they're there to develop this lifelong passion for learning, right? And to develop empathy as they go about their world and about their lives. Let's think about what that would look like for the teacher. We just talked about the globally competent student, but what about for ourselves? What skills and what do we need to keep in mind and to further our own learning? Because I think the best teachers are constant students. And so we want to think about branching out, again, learning about different perspectives. Don't limit yourself to those go-to countries, you know what I'm saying? French teachers, get beyond France. Spanish teacher, let's get beyond Spain. And think about, you know, where these languages are spoken, you know, in a global world, right? Also, constantly refining our own skill as to how we relay that to students, right? Is there another way I can present it to students where it doesn't seem so foreign, right? We ask our students sometimes, or I know they ask us, well, why do they do it that way? And we can't just settle for just because, or because it's a different culture, right? We need to help them understand why do they do it that way, or why does it look that way, smell, sound that way. And so it really is about making a commitment, I think, on our own part, as well as our students, to help them branch out in that regard. I'm gonna put an article here for you that I referenced in the culturally responsive teaching part, but using their own experience, as I said earlier, right, is a part of the daily instruction, tapping into their background. Yes, that can be a sensitive topic in some classrooms, absolutely. You wanna get to know your students, you want to make sure that you feel comfortable asking about those past experiences. And but some are usually willing to share, and sometimes they're very gratifying, sometimes they could be painful stories, but I think every kid has a story to tell. And as we said earlier about tapping into their heritage in terms of language and their family, again, which could be a sensitive subject for some students, but let those who are willing to share. I know it's a very popular topic in most Spanish classrooms. They're usually very proud to talk about their siblings and the close-knit family, the longevity of their grandparents and that sort of thing. And then, of course, we think about inclusion, right? And that goes beyond just language, ethnicity, but how do we make every student feel a part of that classroom? And I would say, you know, I don't know to whom to credit this quote, but I remember one of my professors in college saying, they don't care how much you know until they know how much you care. And that to me really supersedes anything we can do in a language classroom, right? Getting to know students. I would say that was my single biggest success, if I experienced success as a high school teacher, was that Spanish had to come second, right? That I really could not begin to talk about what I was passionate about, language and culture, until I really knew the students. And that really, even though I had to give up some time, perhaps at the beginning of the year, at the beginning of each class, I really wasn't giving up. Okay, I was paving the way. I was setting the stage for what I feel like was culturally responsive teaching and doing some of the things that we say here. Can't go without high expectations, right? We know that teenagers, well, human beings, right? They tend to reach for the low-hanging fruit. And when we get busy, we get stressed, we tend to maybe cut corners, but we wanna make sure that we maintain rigor, but yet also that empathy and we talked about earlier. All right, let's get to some tools. I don't know about for you, but I've learned these recently within the last year or two. And we're gonna talk about three tools that you can use for distant learning. Classroom screen. I'm going to go out and show you these and demonstrate them for you. We'll go in this order: Mentimeter, which is, let's start with classroom screen. That's going to be basically a backdrop. You know, we're using a lot of Zoom backdrops. You have my home office here today, but I could put, of course, a scene from the target language community or a nice photo. But the classroom screen is also going to allow you to have a nice space to work where you can have a timer, where you can put the students in groups. You could even have a message board. Mentimeter is a way the students can be engaged with responding to questions. They can create a word cloud. They can respond to a multiple choice question. They can even vote or do a poll. And then Flippity, just a fun pool, a fun tool for name selecting and grouping students. There are many of those online, but that happens to be my favorite. So let's take a quick look at those tools. This is an example of classroomscreen.com. You can see it's nice and blank, right? I chose Machu Picchu as my image, but if I want to change that background, excuse me, let's say that I'm a German teacher. I would rather have the Brandenburg gate there. I can do that. I can add a timer. Okay, just by a click here, I can put the students to say, all right, turn and talk for 4 minutes. We're going to do a quick write. This one's interesting, maybe for younger learners, or if you were using it in a face-to-face situation, you can kind of, you know, gauge the volume in the room. You should be using your whisper voice, or we should be, you know, put on silent for right now. But again, you can put up here, of course, I could change everything to a different language if I wish. So I'll change my backdrop to Spanish, all the icons now in Spanish. We can put up a text, a drawing, a recording, many different things here too. I like this, the stopwatch when they are maybe doing a presentation, it shows a caution light and then red light would be your time is up. So that's classroom screen. I think it's just a nice change of pace rather than looking at a static slide. Let's go to Mentimeter. This one is a free tool up until 3 Mentimeters. In other words, I have 3 questions here. After that, I would either need to buy or subscribe to this, but you can also erase. If you don't really need this question, I can erase it over here on the right-hand side and put up another question. It's as simple as the students on their phone or tablet, they put in this code you see here, put in menti.com, it'll ask for the code and then they're allowed to submit an answer. I like to use this with teacher trainings, right? Which is what I've done here. I think we were just doing a quick feel for the room. I could do a check for comprehension. We were grading some essays at this particular workshop. So I had them put in their score and anonymously, I get a bar graph in real time as to the answers that I got. And then lastly, we mentioned Flippity. This is one that allows you to choose a name from a hat randomly, but it also has a lot of other tools that you can do here. So I could put them in groups of 3, groups of 4. I can shuffle those groups, okay, for a jigsaw. I could put them in 2 teams very quickly. Just many different things. And I even used this with my college kids. They came in and they saw on the board, okay, today we're going to be working in trios, and they would immediately take their seat accordingly because they of course knew each other. We did that the first couple of days. So Flippity has many, many options. I'll go back to the slides and show you some of the ways in which you might use it. All right, and we want to make sure our closed caption is on. Okay, so you can see again the possibilities with, Teresa, I'm not getting the closed caption here.
So when you hover down at the bottom on the left-hand side, the toolbar should pop up.
Gotcha. There we go, we're back. Okay, so here are the different configurations for, like we said, choosing a name, maybe just have a lineup for who's gonna be called on next. But those were things in which we were talking about earlier. So again, we have classroom screen, we had Mentimeter and Flippity. So try those out, good for any language. All right, let's use some of these authentic resources and media that I mentioned earlier. I really like this quote for Spanish teachers, right? Thinking about We want to make sure our students see students that look like themselves, and that they're seeing people of color, that they see that this language is spoken not just in textbooks and classrooms. So I really enjoyed this interview here from Jadel Martinez. Again, I'll have to turn off closed captions to hear her, but I'd like for you to just hear a bit of her message.
You know, it was a bit complex for me. I didn't always want to identify as Black. There were times I didn't want to identify as Latina.
I felt that I didn't really fit in either population sometimes. So I was maybe too Black for Latinos and too Latino for African Americans.
I just
think about that. Too Black for Latino, too Latino for Black. Your students are feeling those same struggles sometimes. And I just really enjoyed this article. You may be thinking, well, why would I do that in English, right? Or I'm a 100% target language classroom. Think about the flipped classroom. This is something that you could have students watch on their own asynchronously and then resume that discussion in Spanish if they are of the level to have some sort of exchange or debate. You could turn it into a writing prompt, right? If you don't if you want to use the English in your classroom, for example. But even for novices, I sometimes think, okay, that'll be my 10%, right, in my target language classroom or in my remote classroom in particular. So just check out that. And there's lots of good information on this Garifuna community in Honduras. French teachers, if you don't know Black M, you're missing out. Again, just a real engaging performer. Again, I have him queued up here. I'll show you in just a moment. But this one I borrowed from my French teacher, of course, who is very innovative, very in tune with her students, makes a very cognizant effort to make sure she's including the entire French-speaking community. So let's take a quick look at Black M and what he has to say.
Appelez-moi quelqu'un là. Parce que... Oui. Ouloulou. Ouloulou. Monsieur, vous m'écoutez? Monsieur. Monsieur. Il transforme en Pokémon ou quoi? Tout le monde me regarde. À travers mon innocence, je pense qu'il me charme. Ma maîtresse d'école m'a dit que j'étais chez moi. Mais mon papa, lui, pourtant, se met fidèle. Est-elle fidèle? La France est belle, même regarde haut comme la tour Eiffel. Mes parents m'ont pas mis au monde pour toucher les ailes. J'ai vu que Mario m'a tweeté de quoi elle se mêle. Je sais qu'elle m'aime, je suis français. Ils veulent pas que Marianne soit ma fiancée. Peut-être parce qu'ils me trouvent trop français.
All right, I'm going to stop him there for a moment. If you have not seen him, like I said, check him out because he really is engaging for the students. I can't think of something more appropriate to talk about given the situation we see in this country this evening. If you feel comfortable doing that, of course. But we need to address their concerns and what students are seeing and feeling. What could you do with that? Let's say at a novice level, you say, well, my students will never understand the lyrics to that song. Besides just doing a close fill-in exercise, we could have them write about the images they saw, right? There was a lot going on there in terms of music, message, the images, the faces we saw, to just do a quick turn and talk with their neighbor, or to let them write freely for 4 or 5 minutes. And it doesn't need to be organized. It doesn't need to even be in good French. And it certainly doesn't need to be collected and graded by you, right? Think about using that as a formative way to introduce public and personal identities, or to introduce them to speakers of the Francophone world. Let's move on. In that same vein, I like to do a similar theme in my own class. This would be good for intermediates, level 3 or 4 could handle this little poem called The Ballad of Two Grandfathers by Nicolas Guillen. He's an Afro-Cuban poet. all of many of his works are online, including his voice reading his own poetry. But I'd like to start with this little graphic here that a student drew, and it gets the students thinking about, well, why are these men out seemingly holding hands on a beach, right? But we see quickly that one is the Abuelo Negro and the Abuelo Blanco, right? And it's the talking about the encounter and the miscegenation that has taken place not only in the Caribbean, but throughout Latin America. But this is an accessible poem that you can start first by doing, let's say, a mind map. Have them generate ideas about what are their roots, okay? Where do we come from? What was the language of your ancestors, for example? What is your ethnicity? What do you identify? So just as a quick partner or small group activity. And then this is a graphic organizer, very simple, that I use, kind of a T-chart side by side. And we could call this even a during reading or a post-reading activity where they're going to jot down, not in a complete sentence. I don't know about you, but I got over that long ago as a teacher. Everything does not need to be in a complete sentence, right? Sometimes just a one or two word response from a novice communicates the meaning they need. So this could be something like, I say, after the fact, they go back, we ask them to reread this poem. Here I've just put a fragment, and they're going to jot down adjectives to describe both grandfathers, if they can identify the names that they're calling, because it's sort of a call and response or a back and forth. And if you know Guillen's poetry, he really plays into the onomatopoeia and the alliteration and rhythmical. I always had a set of bongo drums under my lectern when it came time to teach Guillen. And just some little gimmick like that was enough to make it so memorable for the students. And again, I wouldn't grade this, okay? Think about formative. This is just a stepping stone to help them start to unlock Afro-Caribbean poetry. It's not going to be something that they master or analyze. And again, I'm a little bit old school in the fact that I often had my students memorize or give them the opportunity to recite or to declaim a poem. And, you know, I feel like in many regards, that was one of the few takeaways that some kids left the classroom with there, that they couldn't necessarily put together a speech or write a paper, but in the end, they could recite a few lines of that poem, and that gave them some satisfaction. All right, next we're going to look at some of the tools from Vista Higher Learning. And if you're not a Vista user, we would love to introduce you to some of our tech tools, which I think are very well suited for remote teaching. In Indiana in particular, Sarah Thompson is your representative, and she is fantastic. She would love to grant you access to try these out and experiment over the summer and get used to them and see if it's something that you really like. For example, one of the features that I think really keeps the materials fresh and up to date, doesn't really even tie to the textbook or the theme you're teaching, is called this News and Cultural Updates. Let me show you. As we go there, we see that every month we archive one of these authentic sources, whether it be print, audio, audiovisual. We have a nice collection that we've been doing this for a couple of years. So I've pulled up the one from April here, for example, and we see El Cambio Climático in Honduras. hold on, I think we need to take some things away. We're getting marks on the screen here. But when we pull up the Cambio Climático, for example, it takes us out again to a video that has been vetted for classroom use. You can, of course, put the subtitles on in English, Spanish, or both. And then the nice thing is, as you saw here, it's already scaffolded for you. We have come up with activities that would make this appropriate for novices. This is your pre-reading activity, a during reading, which is just kind of a yes or no, and then some comprehension questions. And then we end up with open-ended questions in the form of a cultural comparison, thinking that, well, on down the road, perhaps these students will be doing that task, let's say on an AP exam or what we do in class a lot of times. But check these out, because it's a nice tool that this one is excellent from Bolivia. I have to show you just 30 seconds of it, but think about what you might compare here with the crossing guard in your community and these young students who are out promoting safety in the streets.
Y vestidos con el traje del animalito del mismo nombre, estos jóvenes se lanzaron a las calles de la ciudad de La Paz hace 13 años con el objetivo de educar con amor a los ciudadanos y cambiar el rostro caótico del tráfico vehicular en esta urbe. Es la esencia de la...
So again, these are young people who are taking on the role of crossing guards in La Paz. They've dressed up as a zebra, of course, to, you know, play off of the word the zebra or the crossing zone that's painted black and white striped. But I just thought that was excellent to connect the students to an authentic source.
Hey Ken, before you go off that site real quick, when you clicked, we could hear the sound, but we couldn't actually see the video pop up. Okay. Was it in another tab, or could you give us a sense of what that would look like at the user end?
Oh, you couldn't see the video. You couldn't see the one from Honduras either, huh?
No, we could just hear the sound play.
Okay. So, I am in another site. Yes. So that was a YouTube video. Let me see if I can go get it off of YouTube, in fact, and we'll put it in the same browser. Sorry about that, but thank you for letting me know.
While we're on that question, we also had someone ask if there were other resources in other languages besides Spanish on this website.
We do French, Spanish, German, Italian, and English for newcomers, and we are about to launch Mandarin and ASL. So that's what Vista works with. We are exclusively a language publisher. Everything we do is language-oriented. Our technology was built on a language platform. But yes, it's French, Spanish, German, Italian. The part I'm showing you here about news and cultural updates, that's something we do just for French and Spanish, okay? Can you see the video now?
Yes, we can see the video.
Okay, so there again, we were interviewing people along the coast of Honduras. This would piggyback very well on the garifunas that we talked about earlier. And I've already cut away from the zebras in La Paz, but look it up on YouTube, okay? If you put in zebras La Paz, you will get there because there are no zebras in La Paz other than those students helping with the crossing guard. All right, very well. Let's see if that's gonna happen to us again on the next page. This one is a really nice tool in that, Teresa, do you know why I'm getting so many green marks on the screen?
No, that's actually not something I've ever seen before. I don't know if there's...
I don't think it's me drawing, but there seems to be more and more.
Okay, I'll look into that, sorry.
All right. This is what we call a video virtual chat. And this is a chance to speak with an avatar. This is my photo that I uploaded here. And it's basically questions and answers. Again, let me know if you're not seeing what I'm seeing. But I'm going to make a recording. I'll play the role of the student.
¿Qué estación prefieres?
Pues yo prefiero el verano.
¿Prefieres el mar o las montañas?
Pues definitivamente la playa.
¿Y prefieres la playa o el campo?
Pues ya te dije, la playa. Okay, so let's go along with
Cuando
this conversation. I'm going to stop her.
¿Qué te gusta hacer?
This conversation is being recorded. Okay, I can either redo that at the end if I'm not happy with it, or I can submit it on to my teacher for further review. And then you can decide if you want to give them feedback on that, maybe spot check them, or grade them all. The next one is called partner chat. Okay, and here again, just a short 30 seconds of this to let you know what the students are gonna be doing.
Buen día, Eliana.
Hola,
Matt. Bonjour, Kitty.
Bonjour, Brandon.
In your opinion, ¿qué es un amigo?
Pues, Rachel, in my opinion, un amigo es una persona.
Manejando as... Wait, hold on. Oh, wait, just kidding. Let me restart.
Es una persona que tiene afecto para mí.
Un petit ami va danser dans les boîtes de nuit avec moi.
La economía familiar es muy importante, ¿sí?
Describe tu recuerdo.
Okay, I'm going to stop them there, but think about again, what do you see happening? Students using the language with low affective filter, having fun, taking risk, exactly what we would want them to do in our classroom or remotely. And wherever they can get online, they could do this with a phone, tablet, even in the classroom, language lab, something like that. But the partner chat is just really a nice feature that students and teachers love. All right, so I think we've covered those here. Let's go back to this one so I can show you. Let's take a look at another resource for French teachers called Zapping. This again is where we take an authentic piece like a commercial, for example, something very short, and bring it into the classroom unedited again. So I've got this one queued up for you here as well. Let's make sure. Tell me again, Teresa, are you able to see the video or just hear it?
I think it's opening in a new window and the screen share isn't automatically going to that window.
Okay. In that case, I'm going to skip that one because if we can't see it, it's probably not very useful. But yeah, for me, it's just opening up in another window. So we'll skip that one. All right. I'm not sure if you have used ThingLink before, but this is a new tool for me. And I think just a way to make the asynchronous learning a little bit more engaging. I'm able to use an image, a photo that I took here of my own travels, something in a cafe here. You may recognize that as the Musée d'Orsay in Paris. Think about the possibilities with art. And what we're going to do basically is annotate this image. We're going to embed short messages, facts, videos, articles, links to the outside world. So let's go and do that. If I have an example here in German, but I chose the photo of the Christkindlmarkt. And so I click on these little images and it would take me right to a video that I'm going to learn about the cultural products and practices of what goes on in this Christmas market. I believe we're here in Nuremberg. But as I close them out, I may just find that there are images for me to look at. Again, something to spark conversation. What are the people eating? Who are the participants in this? What is there to buy, for example? I put in here again a link to YouTube on the outside, and it's basically images, okay? I don't have to be overwhelmed with German. I'm going to use this simply as a springboard for conversation, brainstorming, trying to get the students to, you know, to pique their interest in why would we be studying about this particular cultural practice. You can also just put in a fun fact, okay, if you want to. This one, again, is another image, but it could just be a caption, okay, maybe the history of the market or what it is that goes on there. Let me see if I can show you another one. Here is, well, let's do one, let's say, for example, with a piece of art. I thought this was great because I always am using art in the classroom. I could point out, you know, This one I'll just put captions in so the students can hover over and see, okay, that's the painter and that's the king and his wife. And over here, I've got his son, the future king, and this sort of thing. So it's just a nice way to embed fast facts or other outside information. Let's go back. All right, so experiment with ThingLink. I have created several and they've not charged me yet, so I'm gonna assume it's a free tool there. All right, let's think about scaffolding. Again, how can I use one source for both a higher and lower level? Let's say I teach level 1, 3, and 5, in which case I may have novice, intermediates, and what we'll call pre-advanced there. So here is a little cortometraje that I've used from Argentina. Again, look online. It's only about 14 minutes long. Can be quite challenging, right? With that Argentinian accent, sometimes the characters speak softly to each other. You really have to do a close listening, right, to fully understand this, but you don't have to understand everything to be able to use it effectively. So it's called Ella y Yo. And let's think about, again, novices. They're not going to get the dialogue, right? And in many cases, they're dealing with very strange, in this case, animals or places and practices. And so I was thinking that maybe just for the novices, we may have them look at that, create a movie poster or look at the trailer, okay, just the minute and a half, and they create their own movie poster, because what do novices do? They do well with memorized phrases such as dates and times and numbers. They could put a price on the ticket for the movie and even try to make a list of the main characters, looking at names, if nothing else. So a very low level task for novices. And then I thought, well, one of the main characters in this is a llama, and that's going to grab their attention right away, because it's a very endearing story where this little boy wants a pet, mom and dad are against it, and they end up taking the llama home, as you might suspect. And so in this case, we're just gonna do a little comparison between the different types of Andean animals that live in this area. And let's go back to something that they're using in the classroom, right? Just basic adjectives to describe them. If they could say one is bigger than the other, or I like this one more, this one's prettier, this one's ugly, this one's brown, this one's white, this would be an easy little activity for them just to describe images that they see. So we're really not using the plot of the movie at all there. Let's go up a level and think about intermediates. At this point, they should be able to create some sort of an original idea. We're hoping for some comprehension also at this point. And so we may set the stage with, here's what we're going to listen for. Very targeted questions, right? Not tell me about the movie. That's a more advanced task. But we want to simply try to identify, what is it that this kid wants? How does he feel? And I can tell you that if we watch the clip, you'll see that he's very whiny. He's very impatient. And so you can just tell by the tone of what the kid is wanting, and that's an animal. And then to describe the characters, right? I think it's very interesting how the guy with the llama kind of passes it off to the father. He gets him to hold it for a few moments, and then he doesn't come back, which adds a little humor into it. We also might just use one of these images, again, to pick up on the descriptions. If I'm doing intermediate low task, I'm going to rely on probably familiar structures to say something, you know, like it's a family, or they are arguing, the mom is angry, the dad is frustrated, the son is sad. Those would be, again, just some basic language functions that they should be able to do as they're knocking on the door of intermediate. But really, comprehension is kind of what we're about, as opposed to when we move up the scale a little bit more, we're going to be looking for interpretation, right? Producing their own original ideas and producing more language. So now we're looking at different types of questions. Notice that here it really is about the why, okay? Not just who, what, and when are they? What is the meaning behind this? And how does it seem to you? So we're opening it up a little bit more, personalizing the questions, almost like a debate in this case. Would go really well with that partner chat we saw earlier, right? If I gave the students these discussion questions, put them in a Zoom breakout room, check on them, come back later, and see if they can actually construct an idea of their own about that particular clip. If we look at the advanced, here is where they should be able to now make a prediction. So I'm going to show just a very short clip and stop it and ask them, what do you think is going to happen next? And so I've stopped it at key points, kind of a cliffhanger where it gets dark, the son and the father are still standing there in the park with that llama on a leash. What's going to happen, right, if the guy doesn't come back to claim it? So I feel like that would be an easy thing for maybe the advanced lows. But let's say we're going on up. I taught AP for many years, teaching university now, they're going to understand most of this clip, right? And so I have to do something besides just ask comprehension questions. So I'm going to ask them to sort of analyze the dialogue, right? By now, we should start to look at the voseo, that, right, that is used in the Southern Cone area. Look at the dialogue, try to identify where the to form is being used versus the vos, And then even take it a little bit higher. If I think about for my heritage students, okay, they certainly understand the Spanish. Well, they might. I also find that that's not always the case, that they struggle a bit, right? If you're used to Peninsular Spanish or Caribbean Spanish, the Argentinian can maybe skew things a bit. But in terms of a heritage variation, you might ask them to think about comparing it to their own situation, right? Or think about a family conflict and how it was resolved, for example. I always like debates. Those were things that my students asked for more of them all along. And so here again, we're just sort of building on the themes in the movie as opposed to what really happened in the clip. Of course, the cortometraje is engaging, but we want to take it a step further. And then maybe even one step higher. Maybe you've got that really superstar student who, you know, is in the advanced range. And so we might ask them to go and research a little bit further this use of the tú and the vos. Here's an article that would get them started, have them use maybe audio and print to source their material and prepare for a 2-minute presentation or even a cultural comparison. So I realize we're about 45 minutes past the hour. I'm going to pause here. Again, remind you that Sarah Thompson would love to hear from you if you want to try out some of those interactive speaking tools. Her email is thompson@vistahigherlearning.com. And then I'll turn it back over to Teresa Israel. Thank you again to IFLTA, the Indiana Language Roadmap, Hamilton School of Global International Studies, and of course, Vista Higher Learning. And thank you all for joining us this evening. It's been a pleasure.
Thank you, Ken. Teresa, Chaimé, do you have questions on the chat?
Yes, so we've had a couple teachers who are very happy to hear that Chinese is being added to the Vista platform, and they had questions about what's kind of the time frame on that launch.
You know what? I wish I could give you that time. And all I can tell you is that we have hired an editor. So we are not just talking about it, we're doing it. That also might be something that we could ask Sarah, because she works more closely with the team in Boston. She actually lives in Michigan, I think, but our home office is in Boston. I can try to get an answer on that, but we generally like to roll things out and make a big splash at ACFL. And I think we're all eagerly awaiting to see if that's even going to happen this year. But I would say within the next year or so, you will definitely hear from our marketing team about that. But I'm not about to put a month or on there a date, because I just don't know the rollout. We're doing all sorts of development right now. We're studying the market. We're seeing what are the needs and how we might set ourselves apart from what's already there. But yes, I see we have a lot of Asian language teachers on the webinar this evening. Thank you for joining us. I hope you got something out of the strategies at least, and we would love to be your language partner in the future.
So we had a couple people talk about how they really like the classroom sites and thought that was fantastic. We had another question about for especially some of the news pieces, turning that into content for the classroom. Are those items periodically updated to kind of keep them relevant for the classroom, or kind of what's the policy for some of that media material?
Yes, in terms of the VHL Super site or VHL Central, that news and cultural update is updated every month. We don't do it during the summer months, but let's say from September through May, we upload something that's happening in the Spanish, French speaking world. And like I say, you may be teaching about the environment, but if something comes up in science and nature, then that would be the feature for that month. And so yes, on the first of every month, we upload either print, audio, or video material. So it's a way of keeping our materials fresh, because we know that, you know, we can only buy books every 10 or 15 years these days. And so yes, it's something that is a part of the book itself, the online materials.
We have a request from Catherine to share a couple resources for French teachers. So I'm going to let her talk.
Okay.
You should be unmuted now, Catherine. I thought I tried to unmute you. Bat in a thousand.
That's okay.
No, it keeps going back on.
Katrine, no, she's not there.
I take the moment to thank Ken Stewart for this presentation while we wait for Catherine.
Yeah, if there's other questions, please feel free to keep sharing them in the chat. Let's see. Catherine, I think you're unmuted now. It keeps going back on and off. She is present, but...
Right, so when we solve that problem, we have a question from Wayfan.
Yeah, let me go ahead and find her so she can speak. All right, I'm unmuting you.
Yes, my question will be, how are you going to do the Chinese book, Mandarin book? Are you going to choose somebody's already made a textbook and make into it, or you are guys are going to write it yourself? So how are you going to going about this? I'm just really curious because I teach in Highland Park High School in Chicago suburb. A lot of teachers are using this. Your guys has this. I was really envy them has all this online platform, all this. Yes. So I just wonder what kind of book are you going to use?
Okay, so again, Sarah is your contact there in the Chicago area. I know Highland Park very well, so she's your contact. The answer to that question is no, we will be developing our own program. Okay, we're not going to repackage or refurbish something that's already there. In fact, we're looking to set ourselves apart from what's already available. And so I would anticipate that there would still be print material, there will be these interactive speaking components. All of our platforms are very parallel. So whether you're doing French, Spanish, German, Italian, the feel of that website is the same. Many of the features, you know, like the partner chat, the vocabulary tutorials, those are common across the platform. So I haven't seen what Chinese is working on, but she might be able to give us a little bit more insight if you want to reach out to her. Like I said, I know they've hired an editor, and we would love to hear from some of the Chinese teachers. We're going to need outside reviewers. We're going to need pilot teachers in classrooms. So absolutely, we definitely want to hear from you and partner with you. So if you have ideas or if you would like to be a part of, say, a mailing list or get more information about how that's coming along, yes, we would love to hear from you. I'll put my email address here at the beginning as well if you want to reach out to me, but Sarah can help you with the access to any of the materials. And like I said, they're being very generous right now in terms of granting people the access because we know people are in a very dire straits with teaching remotely. Thank you for that. You can contact me on Twitter, but you can also contact me at kstewart@vistahigherlearning.com.
Okay, I think Catherine can unmute now. At the very least, she's been sharing some resources in the chat.
Okay.
I think I'm on.
Yay!
Yes, yes,
okay, so thank you so much. I just wanted to share all the things that the ATF is sharing with the teachers for authentic media.
Great.
We've been putting together Wakelet collections, Pinterest boards. Already we had hundreds of those. YouTube playlists. We've got so much for the French teachers that's already organized thematically by the AP themes, not for the AP levels, just for anything, mm-hmm. plus thematically, culturally, etc. So there's thousands of things already for you to go.
And how can we get our hands on them?
I just put them all in the chat.
Okay, thank you so much, Catherine.
Thank you.